Well, good morning. I'm glad you're here this morning as we've gathered in this place to worship God. And hopefully we've had plenty of time for our faith to thaw out and that we can turn around and really, really express our love to God and giving thanks to God for the love that God has for us. Announcements of just a real brief one that we've received the surveys that we're going to receive and are starting to analyze them. And what we ask for is patience in the process. That it turns around and as you can imagine, even sitting around the family table and you ask the question, what do you want for supper tonight? How many choices do you think that Catherine would have? So please be patient. We want to process all of it, and then we want to make sure that we inform the family in the best way that we can that says, here is the best way for us to move forward. And so that will probably be sometime close to Easter. So give us the time. And you know what? The sermon's a little long today. So we're going to just simply say wave to somebody on the other side of the aisle, and that wave will mean that you've all connected with each other. And those on the internet, we want to wave to you, and we want you to be included in the service today in every way, shape, and fashion. And therefore, if we're singing a song, then belt it out at home. You're safe in that space. And worship God this morning with us.
Please stand for the song in the gathering.
Thank you.
Don't be afraid in the night.
God is watching over us.
Don't worry as the day breaks.
God is with us.
Don't be concerned in the middle of the day.
God takes care of us.
Don't fret as the day ends.
God is still beside us.
In every moment.
God is there.
Please be seated.
Well, I hope you have your Bibles with you this morning as we tackle a broad passage for the entire, we're going to try and cover the entire third chapter of the book of Jonah. And so you have to stay on pace with me, because I'll be asking a lot of questions as I've been processing through, and you'll need to be looking at your Bible. Sometimes I'll mention a verse. Please look at it. Look at it. If you need to, circle it, underline it, whatever the case might be, because the story really begins to jump and pop here. Although first two chapters are simply a background to what God is really going to start doing. So I've been asked over and over again in my 45, almost 45 plus years of ministry, Gordon, what's your next step in the church? Where are you going to take the church next where you're serving? Gordon, in the conference, what's the next step in helping this committee move from this place to this place? And I have to imagine that that might have been the question Jonah was asking himself. Maybe this is the question that we should ask ourselves. Not literally, but what would you do if you had been vomited out of a fish? Yeah, maybe take a shower, someone in the... You see, I started to think and process through that, and just a whole host of things came to mind about what many of us might consider doing. I mean, if you lived in the world we live in today, you'd probably start a reality show, right? Maybe do some interviews, share your story with the world. If you started you would call it the Jonah Show. And if you were offered a host position on a national television talk show, you might say something like, I am Jonah and this is my world. Or maybe if perchance that you had come to some realization that it was a spiritual experience being cloistered into that belly of the fish, and you'd come to this aha moment about God, that maybe you'd start a church. You'd call it Church of the Whales. I mean, we would take all kinds of creative liberties to use this experience to try and catapult ourselves into some kind of position of some fame and maybe even a few dollars in our pocket. After all, who knows when that next experience like that will come your way. But what do you do if you're Jonah? I mean, at this point, Jonah waits for God to tell him what to do next. I mean, that would be a moment of a place of comfort for many of us. Okay, God, you got my attention. Now don't say anything else, God. I understand what you're saying, but don't say anything else. But in Jonah's case, he didn't have to wait very long. Look at the third chapter, verses 1 and 2. It says very clearly, the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. And he said, you go, Jonah, to that great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message that I give you. I don't want you to take your life experience, Jonah. I don't want you to take your education and in priesthoodness. I don't want you to bring all your baggage with you, Jonah. I am going to tell you exactly what to say. I underlined in my Bible a second time, because that seems to be our MO, that we believe that God is a God of second chances. And God often is, but let me say this. Start reading through your Old Testament and even your New Testament, and you'll find out that not everyone in the Bible got a second chance. That's hard to hear, my friends. I know that many of my colleagues and peers, when I was talking to them about, here's the sermon that I think that I'm going to bring out of this passage, they would say, well, Gordon. Now, just remember that God is the God of second chances, right? And I said, what about Ananias and Sapphira in the book of Acts? Oh, go back into the Old Testament in Genesis and ask, what about Lot's wife? All she did was take a peek. It's not like she was going to run back there. She just took a peek. Or check out King Saul, who was removed from his kingship because of his sinful rebellion against God. No second chance. I mean, the fact that God gave Jonah a second chance does not mean that we will always be given a second chance when we disobey God. We need to hear this because, you see, we often read the book of Jonah and we say, Jonah ran away, Jonah was disobedient, Jonah didn't listen, and so on. And look, it was his first time that he did that. And so the first time doesn't matter with God, but it does. We think I'll always get a second chance. Not necessarily. I guess I would say it in this way. We cannot presume on God's second chance grace. Let's keep the Bible in balance, my friends. Let's keep it in balance. Let's not just pick and choose this little section here and say, this is how God will always operate. You see, the really encouraging truth for me is that Jonah's disobedience did not cancel God's call on his life. Sometimes we believe that's all we have to do. If God says, Gordon, do this, and I say, no, all right, that thing that God wants me to do is over. But that's not the case. God's call for Jonah to go to Nineveh was a continual call. And so when the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, it was like, Jonah, listen, you go to Nineveh, and I'm going to give you the word so that you do not mess this up. And that's good news and bad news, isn't it? The good news is God hasn't given up on Jonah. The bad news is God hasn't given up on Nineveh. I mean, this is a lose-lose for Jonah. So I paused and I began to think, all right, Gordon, where would you find yourself in this? What are some of the important things just from those first two verses that really jump out at me and ask the important and the difficult questions in my life? The first thing that I discovered is that God doesn't hold grudges. If we disobey, God doesn't hold a grudge. God says, go back, get it done. And in that same line of thought, God doesn't negotiate with us. I think that's where we often think that, you know what, we turn around and say, this is what we're willing to do for you, God. And that's not the way the relationship works. God doesn't negotiate when we rebel against God's ways and God's will in our lives. Oh, yes, God may give us a second chance to follow through, but it doesn't change the fact that God could say, okay, there's someone else in line. Secondly, is that God doesn't lighten the load. The message is the same. You go to the cruel group of people in Nineveh, and you turn around and you tell them, this is the way it is. Thirdly is that God doesn't give up. I mean, if all God cared for was Nineveh and the Ninevites, he could have gotten somebody else. I mean, the good news is God cares for us as well and wants us to be in right relationship and obedient to God and God's ways. In fact, I kind of look at it this way, that God really knew that Jonah had this evilness inside of him. And he wanted Jonah to confront this evil in his own heart, because if we allow evil to continue, prejudice to continue, sin to continue in our lives, it will tear us apart and we will be lost from God. God wanted to take that evil and change it and say, Jonah, these are people I love too. Now, again, I put myself in God's view and in God's perspective, but I go and I take Jonah's perspective now, and Jonah hears these exact words. You get up, you hoof it to Nineveh. That enough would bring fear. I mean, fear. He knew all about the bloodthirsty atrocities that the Assyrians committed. And I can imagine if I'm sitting there and I heard that and I was Jonah, I'd say, are you sure, God? I think that seaweed's still in my ears. Because I know what they do and how they do, and I won't last 10 minutes there. Aren't you sure, God, that you can use me someplace else where my ministry will be longer than 10 minutes? I mean, I'll be a corpse before I get the word God out. Well, then there might have been shame. I mean, he failed the first time, and that, how do I know that I'm not going to get closer each step I take, and that shame that I didn't do the first thing? And finally, I think the deepest part is that continued hatred for all that Nineveh stood for. So I come to this conclusion, even though there is this moment of despair in this belly of this fish, it hasn't changed who Jonah is. He still has a deep disgust for the Assyrians. He still wanted them and wanted God to send them directly down to hell. I mean, the third verse says that Jonah obeyed. Look at that. He obeyed the word of God and went to Nineveh, I'm sure pouting. I mean, before this, Jonah had a stinky attitude against what God was asking. After this whale situation, this fish situation, he still has a stinky attitude. But he obeys God's call, which leads me to this other thought that I had. How many times have we been asked to do things that we really don't like, and we do it anyway? I mean, for example, taking out the garbage is not my favorite thing. Picking up socks isn't my favorite thing. But yet we do it anyway, don't we? Isn't it interesting? We'll do something like that, but we won't take the same principle for God's work. But I give Jonah his due. He got up off the beach, cleaned himself off, headed for Nineveh, and I say, good for you, Jonah. Which then brought me to a whole other set of questions. I think it's an important principle. One that we often fall trap in. We say that We're going to do the big plan for the big plan. Dream big. And yet, we never obey. In God's books, a small obedient step always beats our great intentions. Always. Let me say that again, because I think that's important for us as disciples to understand that our small step of obedience always beats the great intentions that we want to project. Nothing wrong with big plans, but in God's eyes, that small step of obedience beats big plans any day. We can dream about tomorrow and we can imagine incredible things, but until we're faithful for today, it means nothing. And so Jonah set out for Nineveh, each step, I think, taking him on a collision course between his prejudice and the Ninevite arrogance. And then put together there the overarching theme of the unlimited love of God. I like what the third verse says. Now Nineveh was, and what does your Bible say? Wonder why that is. I mean, they're ruthless, right? They're godless, right? They don't even know what it is to follow God's ways. How could that be? A very important city. I mean, they worshiped idols, right? If you go back and you read the history of the Assyrians, you'll find that that they were given over to greed. They were always looking for the coin here and the gold there, and they were always looking to build their treasure chest of wealth. Given over to immorality, it mattered not who you slept with, whether you're married or not. It didn't matter if it was a child or an adult. And violence that was so bloodthirsty. I mean, just having one hair, which is all I got, out of position, could get you done in. I mean, these people in Nineveh knew nothing about God and about the Bible. And God says, this is an important city to me? I mean, this city is so important that it's on my heart, Jonah. Oh, I thought about playing a song, but we have so much to get through. God loves people everywhere. I think it's Amy Grant that sings that song. Or no, it's Point of Grace. It's Point of Grace. I think it's four or five ladies that sing that song. God loves people everywhere. God loves the places where people know nothing about God. God loves people who live in great darkness. Now, not my notes, but Catherine and I were blessed to serve a church, and they had very low attendance. They were dying. And the bishop had sent me down there to figure out what was going on and how to revive their spirit and their how to help them grow in their faith and grow in the community that they were there to serve. And I said in a council meeting, and someone said, Pastor, you're not bringing enough people into the church. And I said, excuse me, but I think that's your job. My job is to help nurture them when they come. So why aren't you inviting people to the church? And they said, well, we don't know anybody who's not. I said, your neighbors? All of our neighbors are Christian. I said, are you serious? And they said, yes, every one of our neighbors are Christians. To the left, north, south, east, they're Christians. And so I just let the pause there for a minute. I said, well done, good and faithful church. You've accomplished your mission. It's time we sell this building, and it's time that we move to a place where people don't know God. All of a sudden, they found a lot of people. And they started growing and thriving. And the church became vibrant, became one of the places where people were wanting to come. That's what God is about. God is looking for places where people don't know about the love and grace of God. In the last several years, I've been reading demographics on a different level, and the demographics are fascinating. They talk about the great movements of people. And what they say is, for the first time in history, more people live in darkness of their own making. It's all about me, self. I grab this, I want that. This is mine, it's not yours. But you see, for the longest time, for thousands of years, people who believed in good have far outnumbered people who think and live evil lives. It's switched. Just look at your news. Take a peek at the news and the reports that you hear of people living today who have no reflection of goodness and godliness in their lives. We're living in a world that is increasingly evil. And unless God finds those people important, which God does, that trend will only continue. We have to love the people that are unlovable. I like the hymn that Frank North penned about the frantic pace of life, and it's called "Where Cross and Crowded Ways of Life." Just let me just read the first verse of that. Where cross the crowded ways of life, where sound of cries of race and calm, above the noise of selfish strife, we hear your voice, O Son of Man, or Jesus. God cares about those who are lost. They're very important to him. It matters not where they live, whether they're in the mega cities that are teeming millions of individuals that crowd together, or where it's a specific location. God cares for the lost in Mexico City, Tokyo, Manila, Beijing, Port-au-Prince. God cares for New York, Los Angeles, San Francisco, and even Columbus. God cares where there's godlessness, even in the village of Sunbury, which will soon grow to a city and become a suburb of Columbus. God cares about those who are lost on the farm, those who live in isolated places. God's asking us to have the same heart. That's what he was asking Jonah. It goes beyond our reasonable calculations about this is the most profitable mission field. This is the most practical way in which we can do this. This is the best way to finance. All those are out the window when we turn it over to God. Now remember, Jonah came from a rural region in Israel, going to a big city where people hated God and hated anybody who represented God. Verses 3 and 4 inform me that Jonah took 3 days. We might think that it was the walk to every part of the city would take 3 days, but when you look at the commentators on this, the debate is something like this. That includes all the surrounding suburbs of Nineveh, which no doubt there were. There was the walled city of Nineveh, but those that are surrounding, possibly 600,000 people would be associated with that city. It would be like us asking, what's the population of Columbus? And you would ask, well, is that downtown Columbus? Does that include Dublin? Are you talking about all the boroughs, Clintonville and all those around? Or are you just talking about downtown? And that's what most commentaries say about this. So Jonah starts his trek through this important city where people know nothing about God. And he doesn't coat the message. It's a message directly from God. God does not coat a message against sin. 8 words. 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. Fourth verse. That's the whole message. Eight words in English. Be surprised, in Hebrew, it only consists of four words. Four words. My friends, try to boil down the message of Jesus Christ into very succinct message. We get all off on these other tangents of things, and the message gets lost. God knows that the direct approach is always the best approach. Your life is not lived right with God. Do you want to make a change? Oh, we say that'll scare people away. That will turn them away. They'll be angry. Well, they'll be angry with the messenger, God. The one who gave the message to each of us to proclaim. To be honest, I've never preached an eight-word message in my entire life. Just saying. Eight words, 40 more days. Oh, we'd say it's even a depressing message, right? Wouldn't we want to say, listen, in 40 days, you got a chance to really experience God's grace. Are you in? Maybe. All right, we might be able to slip at the 42 or so. You know, God might be distracted. I can imagine someone saying, who is this guy? Does he know who we are? What's that? You know, he just arrived in Nineveh, right? He doesn't know us at all. I mean, how can he have a message like that when he just arrived? He's not from around here. That's what I hear. I can imagine when Jonah gives his four-word message, 40 days, someone saying, his accent's a little strange. I can imagine the message being said and someone says, well, doesn't he smell like rotten fish or something? I mean, let me tell you how we would do it. We'd start to put together a Nineveh for Jesus campaign, wouldn't we? We'd hire an advance team. We'd get a PR person together to put an ad campaign in place, buy billboard space, get the social media blitz going, start a Facebook page. Get our Twitter team up and running. Make some Nineveh for Jesus t-shirts. Do some training. Set up buses and carts to bring people from the surrounding areas. We'd have follow-up material printed and ready to go. We'd set up several key homes to where we could have prayer meetings to bathe this effort in prayer. And we'd arrange for simultaneous translations for those that are visiting Nineveh. And then we'd rehearse the choir and we'd have a snazzy slogan, organize Operation Nineveh. In the meantime, pastor would have to raise about $3 million just to get us started. Yeah, Jonah skipped all that. A four-word negative sermon. No chance of success, right? Oh, people ask, what's your plan what's your plan for reaching Nineveh? Oh, we're sending Jonah. Isn't he the one who ran away? Yes. Well, what's he going to do there? He's going to walk around and preach a four-word sermon. Four words? Yeah. Well, if that doesn't work, what do you got planned, God? All along, Jonah's saying, I got this in the bag. God's going to destroy them. And I'm going to be a hero back in my home country. I can say this because I've seen it over the years of pastoral ministry that many of our churches preach cheap grace. You got plenty of time. Don't worry about it. You're on a journey. Tell you, the real conversions are the ones that have an immediate turnaround. Even if you've been on the journey a long time, there's an immediate turnaround. It's stand back, it doesn't look like there's much hope. But 5 tells the story. The Ninevites believed God. I like that. It doesn't say, and they believed Jonah in turn. No, they skipped the prophet. They went straight to God. I mean, that says it all. Revealing that genuine nature of faith. And lest we say that conversion really takes time to grab hold of us and change our lives, look at what they did. Immediately, a fast was proclaimed. All of them, from the greatest to the least, were told, put on sackcloth. The king stood up. That's a sign of serious intent in the Assyrian culture. When the king stands up, it says, I am serious about this. He removed his royal robes, which is a sign of humility in his day and his culture. He covered himself in sackcloth, which is a sign of mourning for his people and for his life. And he sat in dust. Kings don't sit in dust. That's a sign of repentance. And then he sends out a call for all to have a time of fasting and prayer, because he says, who knows? God may yet relent from this message and with compassion turn God's fierce anger so that we will not perish. Even the mighty king of Nineveh gets it. And you know what? Jonah doesn't. I mean, this whole city repented, and we've seen nothing like this, even with our great revivals. George Whitfield never saw it, neither did D.L. Moody. Billy Sunday never saw results like this, and nothing ever happened in the worldwide ministry of Billy Graham. A whole pagan city believed God. It would be like saying that Tokyo, all of China, and even closer, can you imagine if all of Columbus heeded this four-word message and turned their hearts not to Sunbury UMC, but to God? It would be like saying that everyone in Dhaka became a devoted Christian, or the whole city of San Francisco became right with God. Cincinnati got on its knees. Columbus, they surrendered themselves to the will of God. Unbelievable. And yet it happened. Because this is what the story tells us. God is the one that is in charge. God knows the hearts that are ripe for revival. They didn't know it, but God did. Now look at the end of the story in verse 10. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, God had compassion. That God was busy working. I asked myself, well, how much faith do you have to have to believe in God? Not much, as long as it's real faith. And it doesn't get diluted with our own personal agendas. Oh, someone turn to Luke 11:32 and read that out loud for us, please. Someone find it, 11:32. Would you, someone stand up and read it, please, for us. You see, even in the Gospels, it's saying, you know what, you're going to be judged more harshly because the people who were godless turned to God. They began to obey God. I personally believe there's going to be thousands of Ninevites in heaven because they turned their hearts to God. They responded. You see, it's our responsibility, my friends. It's our responsibilities to turn our hearts to God so that God can use us. But the question is this, and this is where we find ourselves in many of our churches across the United States. Can God save Jonah? God can save those who are ruthless, evil, and beyond any comprehension that they can change their ways. But can God change us, save us as Christians who have built up all these years of things that get in the way of our faith and God working through us? Have we started preaching our own message instead of the message that God has given us to preach to the world? So I suggest you read the fourth chapter in preparation for next week, our last message in the series on Jonah. Would you pray with me? Most holy God, as we have heard your words this morning, we pray that you would send your word into our community, not only our community of faith, but our community of Sunbury. And I would pray that you would use your people here at SUMC to make a difference in the lives of others. I ask that you would make this the moment in which that happens, to banish our unbelief, increase our faith, and do once again what you did in Jonah's day. Therefore, I ask that you would give your people here at SUMC a heart for this community, that we may not fail in the task of reaching our generation here for Jesus Christ. For we pray in his holy name. Amen.
Will you please stand with us for the prayer of confession and remain standing for the hymn? Ever-present God, we find so much to worry about.
The world seems a scary place, filled with violence and destruction. Things seem to be coming apart, and we don't know what the future holds.
Trying so hard to control what is happening to us.
We look to our savings accounts for security. Our possessions take so much energy and focus. And we ignore those in need, even when they are right in front of us.
Help us place our trust in you, O God.
Remind us of your continuing care for all creation. Teach us to see the needs of the world and to respond with care and compassion, that we may be faithful, gentle, loving people.
You may be seated. As we enter into this moment of basically coming before Jesus, before God, with who we are and what God has asked us to do, we practice the sacrament of Holy Communion. That, my friends, is open to everybody. God's grace is open to everybody, so nobody should be excluded. If you do not feel comfortable or do not want to, that's all right. You can sit in your seat. You can let one of the ushers know, and we will come and serve communion to you if you so like. We do have bread that we will be serving, and there are individual cups. If you would rather have a self-contained little packet, we have them up front for you to take. If you also would rather use a toothpick, we have toothpicks up front if you want to get your bread as well. We will be sanitizing our hands before we serve Holy Communion. Also, I'm asking that ushers, we just put an offering plate in the back, and we will receive our offering as you depart out of here, so that we can make sure that those can get to their Sunday school class as quickly as possible. God be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the God of unity and love.
It is right to give God our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth.
In the beginning, you swept across the earth with your spirit of life and renewal. From the earth's first gardens to mountaintop storms, you have spoken and called us into covenant to be your holy people.
And when we wandered away and fell short of your call, you spoke yet again, calling us to walk in your ways. From laws on tablets to warnings from prophets, you have spoken your truth and renewed your covenant with us, reviving our souls and rekindling our holy calling with your grace and love. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, there is none beside.
holy are you, and blessed is your holy name. In the fullness of time, you sent Christ Jesus to call us to new life and renewed faith. With a holy calling, Christ calls to us even now, reviving our journey of discipleship and strengthening our life of faith. Through Christ's powerful love and endless grace, we are invited into your presence, rescued from our sins and led on your path of justice and righteousness. In Christ's grace, you revive us and make us whole. As children of your new covenant, sealed by water and the Spirit, we come to you now with joy and gratitude, remembering how Jesus shared bread and wine, renewing and reviving the lives of his friends, his most faithful disciples, even as they faced their deepest fears and their greatest sins.
On the night before his death, Jesus took bread and he gave thanks to you. He broke the bread, gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to the disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my life in the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your life-giving acts of love and grace, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as children of your covenant, renewed and redeemed by your grace, in union with Christ's love for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Most holy God, we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the life and love of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed and revived by Christ's love and grace.
By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other, and one in ministry to all of the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forevermore. Amen.
Would those that are assisting come forward at this time?
Okay, please stand for the sending and join us for our closing song. Pursue God's ways, righteousness, holy living, faithfulness, love, endurance, and gentleness. Share the abundance of God's gifts with others. Remember that God is our refuge, the one we can trust. No matter what, no matter when, God will be with you.
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, well, there's a better life. There's a better life. can feel it. Somebody testify. You believe it. You receive it. You can feel it. Somebody testify. Testify.
My friends, as we depart this place, let's remember the God that we serve, a chain-breaking God that breaks us from the chains of everything we hold inside that is contrary to what God is asking us to do and who God wants us to be. So, my friends, go in peace, knowing that the God who led Jonah to the city of Nineveh will also lead us to the people who are lost and need to experience God's love. Go in peace, my friends. Amen.